طيب، الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد، وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد، كما صليت وباركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم، إنك حميد مجيد. إن شاء الله، today we will start translating the book titled The رسالة by Ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani عليه رحمة الله. And we are only doing the introduction of that book. First of all, give you some information about Ibn Abi Zayd عليه رحمة الله. He is Abdullah Abu Muhammad Ibn Abi Zayd, the son of Abi Zayd. His father, Abu Zayd, his name is Abdul Rahman. He was living in the city of Al-Qayrawan. This is a city in Tunisia, even now, still with the same name. Ibn Abi Zayd Al-Qayrawani, he was the imam of the Maliki scholars in his time. And he was their leader or example. And he was very knowledgeable of the madhab of Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas alayhi rahmatullah. And he was a man with great knowledge and memorization, and also a man of narration. He knew a lot of narrations. And he has a lot of books that prove the fact that he was very knowledgeable. He was a pious man. And he was someone who had knowledge and understanding. And he, as I said, he was basically the leader of the scholars in his time in that area. He was born around 310 Hijra, and he died around 386 Hijra. So he is a scholar from the 4th century, the 4th century of Al-Hijra. And Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi said about him that he is the Imam, the great leader in religion, Al-Allama, that he is a very knowledgeable person, Al-Qudwa, he was an example to be followed, Al-Faqih, the one who is knowledgeable of the fiqh, the jurisprudence, Islamic jurisprudence, عَالِمُ أَهْلِ الْمَغْرِبِ, the scholar of the people of the western part of the Muslim world. He said about him also that he, rahimahullah, this is Ibn Abi Zayd, he was upon the way of the salaf, عَلَى طَرِيقَةِ السَّلَفِ. He was upon the way of the pious predecessors, فِي الْأُصُولِ, regarding the foundations of the religion, regarding the belief or the creed. لا يدري الكلام ولا يتأول. He did not get involved in philosophy, and also he did not get involved in basically altering the meanings of the attributes of Allah. Then he said at the end, فنسأل الله التوفيق, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala facilitation. This work, basically, Al-Imam Ibn Abi Zayd, he was asked by another scholar who was basically a teacher, teaching the children, teaching them the Qur'an and memorization of the Qur'an. So that scholar, he asked Ibn Abi Zayd to write for him a treatise that can be used, that the children can memorize. So he wrote that. It is regarding fiqh, and most of it actually is about fiqh, the fiqh according to the Maliki madhab. But then the introduction of it, he mentioned matters of belief, which is basically the Islamic beliefs. These beliefs are the beliefs of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, and the second generation and the third generation and those who followed them, including the four imams and the great imams of Islam that followed. This is the subject of this introduction. And this introduction is not big, it's not, you know, like it's 3 pages maybe, about 3 pages or 4 pages. But then it includes the basic Islamic beliefs. And what we are doing is we are going to go through this text of Ibn Abi Zayd, alayhi rahmatullah, and then we are going to translate the explanation of that text, the explanation of it that is done by a great scholar of Islam who is still now, still living nowadays, the Shaykh Abdul Muhsin Al-Abbad, hafizahullah ta'ala. Shaykh Abdul Muhsin Al-Abbad is one of the well-known scholars of Islam. He is a teacher at the Masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Masjid al-Nabawi, and he was the head of the Islamic University for a long time, Islamic University in Medina. So this is basically what we are going to do, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us and to assist us and to make us from those who listen to the statement and follow the best of it, and to make this sitting a blessing for all of us. Al-Imam Ibn Abi Zayd starts by saying, باب ما تنطق به الألسنة وتعتقده الأفئدة من واجب أمور الديانات من ذلك الإيمان بالقلب والنطق باللسان أن الله إله واحد لا إله غيره ولا شبيه له ولا نظير له ولا ولد له ولا والد له ولا صاحبة له ولا شريك له. He says in this section regarding, this is a section regarding what the tongues utter and the hearts believe in of the obligations of the matters or the affairs of the religion. Part of that is believing by the heart and the utterance by the tongue that Allah is one God, that Allah is one God, there is no God other than Him, there is no similitude or there is no resemblance to Him, and there is no equal to Him, and there is no son for Him, and there is no father for Him, and there is no companion or a wife for Him, and there is no partner to Him or for Him. This is what Al-Imam Ibn Abi Zayd started by mentioning. So Ibn Abi Zayd Al-Qayrawani said that in the beginning of this treatise is actually meant to mention the rules of fiqh, the Islamic jurisprudence. So he did not really write a booklet on aqidah, on creed by itself or separately here. Rather, he put the matters of belief in the introduction of his risala. The word risala means message or a letter, right? Ar-risala, this is what he called his book, ar-risala, the message or the letter or the treatise, right? That's what he called it. So the introduction of it has the matters of belief. Shaykh Abdul Muhsin, hafizahullah, he said that his treatise that he authored about Islamic jurisprudence now has gathered between two matters of fiqh or two matters of understandings. Al-fiqh al-akbar, the greater type of understanding, and that is what is linked or what is connected or what is related to matters of belief, creed. Creed which there is no ijtihad in it. No ijtihad. No ijtihad meaning that the matters of belief we just receive from Allah and we believe in them as we are told. There isn't a room for putting effort in trying to reach a ruling regarding them. Those matters of belief, they are taught to us or mentioned to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we just take them and believe in them. It has the fiqh al-akbar, the greater understanding, and it has fiqh al-furu', which is the compared to the greater, this is the smaller type of understanding. He called it fiqh al-furu', the rules of fiqh, or rulings pertaining to the rulings of fiqh, the branches of the religion. The branches of the religion, branches of the religion which there is room for ijtihad. There is room for scholars to put in effort in order to reach conclusions. That is why you find the scholars, they may differ in terms of matters of fiqh. What are the conditions of salah? What are the pillars of salah? Matters of wudu, is this a must? Is this recommended? Is this halal? Is this haram? There may be a lot of differences in this regard. But matters of aqidah, because they are not matters of ijtihad, they are not matters that are left for the scholars to reflect and therefore ponder and then reach a conclusion. Matters of aqidah are not like that. Right? That is why difference in them is none or very little. That is, of course, the scholars of the Sunnah, the scholars who follow the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions radiyallahu anhum. So then he meant to author a book about fiqh, like the fiqh of salah, fiqh of tahara, purification and prayer and like that, fasting and hajj and like this. But then in the introduction he mentioned matters of belief. So this is a risala that contained now both the greater understanding, which is matters of belief, believing in Allah and His angels and His books and His messengers and like that. And it contains also the fiqh rulings pertaining to wudu and tahara and fasting and the rest of the matters of fiqh. Now, Ibn Abi Zayd, he said that part of that is believing in the heart and pronouncement by the tongue. Sheikh Abdul Muhsin, he says that here Al-Imam Ibn Abi Zayd, he mentioned specifically the belief of the heart and the statements or the utterance of the tongue. He said this is because what the Muslims believe in, it is required for the belief to be within the heart. And also it is required for the belief to be also on the tongue. On the tongue. Now, he did not mention the actions of the body parts. That is because he mentioned it elsewhere. He mentioned it as part later on. And he mentioned it even before actually starting this aqidah, he mentioned the actions of the body parts. The Shaykh Abdul Muhsin said that these words of Ibn Abi Zayd rahimahullah, it includes affirming that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only God that is worthy of worship, and it includes negation of seven matters. He started by saying that belief in the heart and the utterance of the tongue, that Allah is one. Allah is one God. There is no God other than Him. This is what he starts with. So he affirms that Allah is only one God. Then he negates seven matters. He negates seven matters. Seven matters negated here is La ilaha ghayruh. There is no God other than Him. And he negated also any similitude or any similarity or anyone being similar or resembling God. La shabih. And also he negated the equal, that there are no equals to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He negated the son, and he negated the wife, and he negated the partner. So he said that Allah is one, there is no God other than Him. This is taken from the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَإِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الرَّحْمَنُ الرَّحِيمُ. And your God is just one God. There is no God except He, the Beneficent, the Merciful. And this clarifies or includes clarifying that Allah is one and He is the true God. Allah is one and He is the true God, the one that should be singled out by acts of worship or ibadah, and that none should have any share of the worship that the human beings perform. This great matter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the messengers and sent down the books just for this great matter, for Allah to be worshipped alone without any partner. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَاعْبُدُونَ. And we did not send before you of a messenger except that we reveal to him that surely there is la ilaha illa ana, that there is no God, there is no true God except I, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so worship me. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ اِعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. And surely we have sent in every nation a messenger that worship Allah and stay away from الطاغوت. Stay away from الطاغوت. الطاغوت is generally anything that is taken as a god besides Allah. This is طاغوت. Generally anything that you transgress the limits by that thing, if you transgress your limits by whatever that causes you to transgress, then that thing that causes you to transgress your bounds, then that becomes a taghut for you. That becomes a taghut for you. Inshallah, there will be more explanation to the word a taghut, inshallah, because it includes a lot of different things. But this is the general meaning of it, or the root meaning comes from one transgressing the limit. So if, for instance, one worships a messenger or worships an idol, then he transgressed his limits, the limits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala set, that there should be no worship directed to anyone but Allah. So if someone worshipped something, then that thing becomes a taghut. That thing becomes a taghut. طيب. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created jinn and men except for my worship. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the creation, sent the messengers, and sent down the books to order them, to order the people to worship Allah alone and to leave out worshipping other than Him. And this type of tawheed, this type of monotheism, and that is called tawheed al-uluhiyya, the tawheed al-uluhiyya, the monotheism in terms of the godhood of Allah, the monotheism in terms of Allah being the God. And that is to single out Allah by all acts of worship. This is one of the three types of at-tawheed, the three types of monotheism. These three types, which are tawheed al-uluhiyya, the oneness of Allah in terms of Him being a God; tawheed al-rububiyya, the oneness of Allah in terms of Him being a Lord; and tawheed al-asma'i wa-sifat, the monotheism of Allah in terms of His names and attributes. So tawheed al-uluhiyya, the oneness of Allah in terms of Him being the God, then this is basically actualizing the oneness of Allah by the actions of the human beings. يعني singling Allah out by the actions that the human beings perform. Like الدعاء, supplication or calling. And like استغاثة, seeking rescue and relief. And استعاذة, seeking refuge and shelter. And الذبح, slaughtering. And النذر, vowing. And other types of worship. And other types of worship. All of these types of worship, it is a must. It is obligatory upon the servants of Allah to make these actions that they do specific and special to Allah Azza wa Jal alone, and that they should not make any partner with Allah when they perform them. This is what is meant by Tawheed al-Uluhiyah, believing that Allah is one in terms of Him being a God, meaning worshipping Him alone without any partner. All of the acts of worship must be directed to one and only, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why sometimes it is called Tawheed al-Uluhiyah, Tawheed, the oneness of Allah in terms of Him being a God. Or sometimes they call it Tawheed al-Ubudiyah or al-Ibadah, Tawheed of worship, because that's what it really entails, right? Allah is the only God, the true God, that all the acts of worship should be directed to Him alone. If you look at it from the side of God, if you look at it from the side of the human beings, then it is actually Tawheed al-Ibadah, the oneness of Allah in terms of worshipping Him, that He must be worshipped alone without any partner. So this is the Tawheed of Allah by the actions of the servants. So all the actions that the servants do, acts of worship, they must be directed towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. The second type of Tawheed is Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. Al-Rububiyyah, the word Rabb, we use Lord for it in English. The word Lord in English is not as comprehensive as the word Rabb in Arabic, right? But then, that is one of the closest words to use. So monotheism, or the oneness of Allah in terms of Him being a Rabb, a Lord. This is actually the oneness of Allah in terms of His actions. And that is like the creating, like providing, like causing to live and causing to die, and also controlling and running the affairs of the universe. And the rest of the actions of Allah that are special and specific to Him, that He has no partner with Him in those actions. There is no creator other than Allah. There is no provider other than Allah. There is no one who controls and runs the affairs of the universe except Allah. There is no sustainer except Allah. So this is the meaning of Allah as a Rabb. You have the word ilah, ilah, which is coming from the act like worship. And the one who is worshipped is ilah. The one who creates, the one who sustains, the one who provides, the one who controls the universe, the one who runs the affairs of the universe, the word for that is the word Rabb. The word Rabb. That's why I'm saying the word Lord in English is not that close or not exact, but that's the closest that is being used. And also the third type of Tawheed is the oneness of Allah in terms of His names and His attributes. And that is to affirm whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has affirmed for Himself. And whatever His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam affirmed for Him of the names and attributes, we affirm them in a way that suits the greatness, suits the perfection or the perfectness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His grandeur. Without believing in the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, without tamthil, without likening them to the attributes of the creation, and without takyif, without asking or talking about the how of these attributes are, and without tahrif, without alteration, without twisting the meanings of these names and attributes, and without ta'til, without stripping those attributes and names of their true meanings. So we affirm the oneness of Allah in terms of Him being a God, and in terms of Him being a Rabb, and in terms of His names and attributes. We affirm that He is one in all of these. And we said that the types of Tawheed are three. How did we get this? The Shaykh Abdul Muhsin Hafidhullah, he said that this division to the types of Tawheed into three, this is known or was known through istiqra, through comprehensive study of the Quran and the Sunnah, of the text of the Quran and the Sunnah. And he will give us clarification. He says that this can be clarified by the first surah in the Quran, and also by the last surah of the Quran. For both of these two surahs, the first surah and the last surah, they include the three types of Tawheed. As for Surah Al-Fatiha, the first surah, then the first ayah in it, and that is Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise is due or belongs to Allah, the Lord of the worlds. He said this ayah, the first ayah, it includes those three types of Tawheed. For saying Alhamdulillah, all praise belongs to Allah, or all praise is due to Allah, in this there is Tawheed al-Uluhiyah, the oneness of Allah as a God. That is because attributing praise to Allah by the servants, for the servants of Allah to attribute praise and all praise to Allah, this is a form of worship. This is ibadah. The one of us, when you say Alhamdulillah, O Allah, it means, O Allah, you are deserving of all praise. By you saying that, you are worshipping Allah. So this is the oneness of Allah in terms of Him being the true God. Then it says, Rabb al-Alameen, Alhamdulillah, all praise is due to Allah. This is the oneness of Allah as a God. Rabb al-Alameen, now you are affirming Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord, the oneness of Allah as a Lord, that He is the Lord of the worlds. Al-Alameen is everything other than Allah. You have Allah and you have Al-Alameen. Everything other than Allah is created. Everything other than Allah is created. So Al-Alamun, they are whoever besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, other than Allah. For there is nothing in existence. There is nothing in existence except a creator and a created. A creator and a created. Allah is the creator, and everything other than Him is created. And one of the names of Allah is Ar-Rabb, the Lord. As for the statement Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, then this includes the oneness of Allah in terms of names and attributes. Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, they are two names of the names of Allah. They are basically establishing an attribute of the attributes of Allah, and that is the attribute of Ar-Rahmah, mercy. And the names of Allah, all of them are derived. There isn't a name of Allah that is not derived. And every name of the names of Allah is establishing one of the attributes of Allah. When he said that all the names of Allah are derived, meaning they have a root meaning and they are derived from that. So for instance, the word Allah, it's actually the word Al-Ilah, Al-Ilah, which means the God, right? And Al-Ilah, basically they dropped the Hamza and they pushed the lambs together, so it became Allah, right? That's where it comes from, right? There are names that are not derived, right? They are not derived from something else. They are just names, right? They are not derivatives of something. It's just a name that is given. This is what is called jamid, not derived, that is. But all of the names of Allah are derived, meaning that they have a root meaning, and then from that word, derivatives came. Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, right? Most gracious, most merciful, it's coming from Ar-Rahma, right? They are derived. They are derived. Okay? Tayyib. The next ayah is Maliki Yawm al-Din. Maliki Yawm al-Din. Master of the Day of Judgment. In this is the affirmation of the oneness of Allah in terms of Him being a Lord, Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. It says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner and the master of the Day of Judgment. So we said the Lord, one of the meanings is that Allah is the owner, is the one who created, the one who owns, the one who sustains, the one who controls and runs the affairs of the universe. The word Lord. So here it says that He is the master, the owner of the Day of Judgment. So it affirms the fact that Allah is a Rabb, that He is the owner, that He is the master, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Shaykh says, is the owner of this worldly life, and He is the owner of the next life. He is the master in this life and in the next life also. But then, here in the ayah it says, the master of the Day of Judgment, or the owner of the Day of Judgment. So, the Day of Judgment is mentioned specifically here, that Allah is the owner of it. That is because it is the day in which all the creation, everybody, will be subdued and will humble themselves before Allah, the Lord of the worlds. Unlike this worldly life, for this worldly life, there are some people in this worldly life who acted arrogantly, who acted with tyranny, right? And one of them said, Fir'aun, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى, I am your greatest or the highest, the most supreme Lord, right? This is a human being said that in this life. But then in the next life, on the Day of Judgment, no one would be able to make such a statement. It is on that day where the ownership of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to everything will be manifested without any challenge. In this life, there could be some tyrants, there could be some disbelievers who claim, or arrogant people who claim such a thing. But on the Day of Judgment, there is none of that. Everybody will be subdued, everybody will be humiliated and humbled before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next ayah, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, you alone we worship and from you alone we seek help. In this, there is the affirmation of the oneness of Allah in terms of Him being the true God. Now here, the structure of the ayah, it doesn't say we worship you and we seek help from you. Rather, the structure of it says it is you alone that we worship, and it is you alone that we seek help from. Right? So here, this structure benefits us restriction. This is a very strong way of presenting this. It's not only we worship you. It is you that we worship. Right? It restricts all worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is you, the one whom we seek help from. Restricting, seeking help and assistance, restricting that to seeking it from Allah Azza wa Jal alone. It means we make our worship, our acts of worship, special and specific to you. And also seeking help, we make that special and specific to you only. We do not associate any partners with you in that. Then the ayat go on to say, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Guide us to the straight path, the path of those whom you bestowed favor upon them. They are not the one who earned your anger, or the ones you are angry with them, and not the ones who are astray. In this, the Shaykh says, there is the affirmation of the oneness of Allah in terms of Him being the true God, Tawheed al-Uluhiyya. For seeking guidance from Allah is dua. Seeking guidance from Allah is supplication. And Allah and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الدُّعَاء هُوَ الْعِبَادَةِ. Supplication is the worship. So the servant of Allah asks his Lord in this dua to guide him to the straight path, the path which the prophets, the most truthful ones, the martyrs, and the pious, this is the path that was trodden, or the path that all of these were mentioned. All of them, they walked in that path. The Nabiyun, Siddiqun, Shuhada, and Salihun. Those who are the people of Tawheed, the people who are upon the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the servant of Allah also is asking Allah to save him and to make him stay away from the path of those whom Allah is angry with and those who are misguided. Those who were not upon at-tawheed. Those who were not upon at-tawheed. Rather, what happened from them, or what they did, is actually they have fallen into shirk. They have fallen in associating partners in worship, and they worshipped others along with Allah Azza wa Jalla. So this first surah, Surah Al-Fatiha in the Quran, it affirms the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one in terms of Him being a God. He is one in terms of Him being a Lord. And He is one subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of His names and attributes. As for Surah An-Nas, the last chapter or the last surah in the Quran, then it says, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. Say, I seek refuge with the Lord of the people. In this, there is the affirmation of the three types of Tawheed, or oneness of Allah. For seeking refuge with Allah is part of Tawheed al-Uluhiyya. You are asking of Allah to give you shelter, to give you refuge. So this is part of Tawheed al-Uluhiyya. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. By the Lord of the people. And this is the affirmation of the oneness of Allah in terms of Him being the Lord, Ar-Rabb, and also Tawheed al-Asma wa al-Sifat, the oneness of Allah in terms of His names and attributes. So you are asking, قُلْ أَعُوذُ. So this Tawheed al-Uluhiyya, you are calling upon Allah and supplicating Him. بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ, you are affirming that He is the Lord, the Creator, the Sustainer, the Provider, the Controller, the owner, right? And you are saying بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. Here you are affirming that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord, and the Lord is one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said this is like the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the beginning of Surah Al-Fatiha, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, right? All praise is due to Allah. This is now you are praising Allah worshiping Allah by attributing to Him all praise. This is worship. And you have the names of Allah and Rabb within the same ayah. So you are affirming the three types of Tawheed. Also, Malik al-Nas, the owner of the people. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ, the owner of the people. In this is the affirmation of Allah being the Lord and affirming also the names and attributes of Allah as He is the Malik, He is the owner, right? And He is the King, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then it says, إِلَهِ النَّاسِ, the God of the people, right? Well, in this, there is the affirmation of Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, the oneness of Allah as a God, and in it also the oneness of Allah in terms of His names and attributes, because it's affirming the name al-Ilah for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, the relationship between these three types of Tawheed is for us to say, the Sheikh says, that Tawheed al-Rububiyyah wa Tawheed al-Asma'i wa al-Sifat mustalzimani li Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Oneness of Allah in terms of Him being a Lord, and the oneness of Allah in terms of His names and attributes, they necessitate, they lead one to the oneness of Allah as a God, meaning they will lead him to worshipping Allah alone. If you know that Allah is the Rabb, is the Lord, the one who created and provided, the one who is running the affairs, the one who is the owner and the king and the master. And if you believe in the rest of the names and attributes of Allah, this will lead you to hold Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be one in terms of Him being a God, meaning that He is the only one true God that exists, and therefore this will lead you to worship Him alone. So these three types of Tawheed, they are related to one another. The Rububiyyah, the Lordship, and Asma wa Sifat, names and attributes, they necessitate, they would lead one to worship Allah alone, to have Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. And Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, the oneness of Allah being a God, is inclusive of both of them. Is inclusive of both of them, meaning the one who affirms that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one true God, is the only one true God that deserves to be worshipped alone, the one who affirms that, he would be affirming that Allah is the Lord and that Allah is the one who has the names and attributes, right? Without any partner, that no one is resembling him in those. That is because if the one affirms, or that is because the one who affirms that Allah is the one to be worshipped alone, and he made the ibadah, worship, he made it special and specific to him alone, and he did not associate any partners with Allah in worship, he would not be one who rejects or denies that Allah is the creator, that Allah is the provider, that Allah is the one who causes life, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who causes death, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the most beautiful names and the highest attributes. So, believing in Allah as a Lord and believing in His names and attributes, this will lead you to worship Him alone. And worshipping Him alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala, without any partner, this means that this person who is doing that, he knows that Allah is the creator, the sustainer, the controller, the provider, and he knows that Allah has all of these names and attributes that no one shares them with him. This is the relationship between the two. The Shaykh goes on to say, as for one who affirms the oneness of Allah in terms of Him being a Lord, and the oneness of Allah in terms of His names and attributes, then it is necessary for this one, it is incumbent on this one, that he should affirm the Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, that he should affirm that Allah is just one God, that none deserves the worship but the one God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Shaykh said that the kuffar, the disbelievers of Quraysh, they affirmed those kuffar that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent within them. They affirmed the Tawheed of Rububiyyah. They affirmed that Allah is the Lord. But then this affirmation did not enter them into the fold of Al-Islam. Rather, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fought them until they worship Allah without any partner. He said, and this is why it comes a lot in the Quran. It comes a lot. What comes a lot? He says the affirmation, yarhamukallah, the affirmation of the lordship of Allah, which the disbelievers they affirmed. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala establishes that He is the Lord. He is the creator, He is the sustainer, controller, owner, runner of the affairs of the universe. He establishes that. Why? Because the kuffar of Quraysh, they used to affirm that. They used to believe in it, that He is the Lord. He is the creator, sustainer, provider, controller. They used to believe that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, many times in the Quran, He would establish that He is the Lord, and then after that he makes it necessary for them, He imposes then on them, since He established the introduction, Allah is the one Lord, which they agree on, that Allah is the Lord. He establishes that in order to establish on them and in order to make it a must and compulsory upon them to affirm the oneness of Allah as a true God, that none deserves the worship but Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, he will give us an example. The examples are many in the Quran, but he gives us this example of this ayat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمَّنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وأنزل لكم من السماء ماء فأنبتنا به حدائق ذات بهجة ما كان لكم أن تنبتوا شجرها أإله مع الله بل هم قوم يعدلون. This ayah, it says, who created the heavens and the earth and sent down for you from the sky water, and by it, by that water, by the rain, we caused by that water that came down, we grew like grass. So it became gardens that are beautiful. Right? That you wouldn't be able to cause their trees to be planted and to grow. And Allah is the one who sent down the rain. And because of that, the grass and the plants came out. And those things, you were not able to do them on your own. Then he says, is it a God with Allah? Is it a God with Allah? Then it says, rather, they are a people who make or set up equals to Allah. Right? So now, here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created the heavens and the earth and then sent down the rain. And because of that rain, you have those grass and vegetation and plants growing up, and you see gardens that are so beautiful, right? Gardens that are so beautiful that you are not able to grow these trees like this. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who did it. Now this is something that they know. Allah is the one who did that. They agree on that. Then he asks them, is it a God with Allah? Is it a God with Allah who did that? Then he says rather they are a people who set up equals to Allah. أمن جعل الأرض قرارا وجعل خلالها أنهارا وجعل لها رواسي وجعل بين البحرين حاجزا أإله مع الله بل أكثرهم لا يعلمون. This next ayah it says, who made the earth as a resting place, and he made within it rivers, and also he made for it mountains, and he made between the two seas a barrier, between the two seas a barrier, you know, the one salty and the other one with the fresh water, there is a barrier between them. Who did that? أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ. Is it a God with Allah? بَلْ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Nay, rather, most of them know not. Most of them do not know. أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءِ وَيَجْعَلُكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ الْأَرْضِ أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. Who responds, who answers the call of the one who is in dire necessity, dire need. Who answers the call of that one when he calls upon him? And he removes the evil. And he makes you successors, succeeding one another on earth. Is it a God with Allah? Very little that you remember. أَمَّنْ يَهْدِيكُمْ فِي ظُلُمَاتِ الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ وَمَنْ يُرْسِلُ الرِّيَاحَ بُشْرًا بَيْنَ يَدَيْ رَحْمَتِهِ أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى اللَّهُ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. Who guides you in the darknesses of the land and sea? And who sends wind? Who sends the wind as a good news? Good news preceding his mercy. You know, the rain, the wind comes and brings the rain. The rain is the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who does that? Is it a God with Allah? High is Allah above what they associate as partners in worship with him. أَمَّنْ يَبْدَأُ الْخَلْقَ ثُمَّ يُعِيدُهُ وَمَنْ يَرْزُقُكُمْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Who starts the creation and then restarts it again? He started the creation and then they will die and then he will resurrect them again. And who provides for you from the heavens and the earth? Is it a God with Allah? Say, bring forward your evidence if you are truthful. A discussion like this, you see it in different places in the Quran. So in every ayah of these ayat is the establishment or the affirmation of Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord, is the creator, is the sustainer, the provider, the owner, the one who runs the affairs of the universe. Every ayah starts with that. Then it makes it necessary for them, if they agree, if they affirm, it makes it necessary for them that exactly that the creator is one, the sustainer is one, the controller is one, the provider is one, the owner is one, then the God should be just one. The one who deserves to be worshipped should be just one. So every ayah of these five verses, after he establishes the lordship, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of lordship, he says, أَإِلَهٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ, inquires, a God, is it a God with Allah? The meaning is that the one who did all of these actions single-handedly, these actions which are the actions of Allah alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala, without any partner, he, the one who did that, he is the one who must be singled out, who must be singled out by worshipping him alone. That is because the one who was alone in terms of creating and bringing into existence, and others, other actions of the actions of Allah, the one who did that, he must be worshipped alone without any partner. يعني the worship must be made special and specific to him alone without any partner. And how can it be? How can it be? Or how can it be understood? How can it be fathomed that the created things which was nothing, and Allah brought them into existence, how could it be fathomed? How could it be understood that these things that were nothing and Allah then brought them into existence, how could it be understood that they would have any share of worship while all of these things are created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If we can get this ayat from the Noble Quran, so we can read the translation inshallah from the Noble Quran inshallah. Time is it? Yeah. It's 8:30. Okay, so we will stop here at the end. Inshallah, ya akhir. These are from Surah An-Naml, the ayat number 60 and on, 60 to 65 or 64. It says, "Is not He better than your gods? Is not He who created the heavens and the earth, and sends down for you water, that is rain between brackets, from the sky, whereby we cause to grow wonderful gardens full of beauty and delight. It is not in your ability to cause the growth of their trees. Is there any ilah, God, with Allah? Nay, but they are a people who ascribe equals to Him. Is not He better than your gods?" That is. "Is not He who has made the earth as a fixed abode and has placed rivers in its midst and has placed firm mountains therein and has set a barrier between the two seas of salt and sweet water? Is there any ilah, God, with Allah? Nay, but most of them know not. Is not He," between brackets, "better than your gods? Is not He who responds to the distressed one when he calls on Him, and who removes the evil and makes you inheritors of the earth, generations after generations? Is there any ilah, God, with Allah? Little is that you remember. Is not He who guides you in the darkness of the land and sea, and who sends the winds as heralds of glad tidings, going before His mercy," between brackets, "rain? Is there any ilah, God, with Allah? High exalted is Allah above all that they associate as partners to Him." So once again, this is Surah An-Naml, the verses 60 to 64. 60 to 64. Then the Shaykh goes on to talk about the fact that for the ibadah, for the worship to be accepted by Allah, for the righteous action to be acceptable by Allah, there has to be two conditions. The first of them is sincerity, and the second of them is for the action to be matching and in agreement with the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We will stop here, inshallah. Inshallah, we will continue next time, bi idhnillahi ta'ala. Jazakumullahu khayran for listening and paying attention. And we will see you next week, inshallah ta'ala. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.